The iPod Touch has fallen from relevance in the past few years. Now, while it still might be the cheapest iOS device Apple sells, you don't see it around a whole lot anymore. But this wasn't always the case, and the iPod Touch 4th generation may in fact be the peak of the iPod Touch line as a whole. Hey, how's it going? I'm Josh from 91 Tech, and today we're talking about the iPod Touch 4th generation and how it holds up in 2019. The 4th generation iPod Touch is perhaps the most remembered, at least for me. When I think iPod Touch, I still to this day think of this one. The 4th generation retained the classic stainless steel design that would scratch way too easily, and managed to bring the first cameras seen in the iPod Touch line. While I didn't have one when I was younger, this was the iPod Touch you wanted when you were a kid. You didn't necessarily need a phone, you just wanted something to play games on, and this iPod was perfect for that. But here we are, a full 9 years after it was released, which is kind of mind-blowing when you think about it. But let's start by talking about the design. Again, it has that stainless steel backing, which looks really good until it's all scratched up and stuff, but hey, nostalgia rules all, so I really like it. On the bottom of the iPod, we have the classic 30-pin charger, as well as headphone jack. Yep, there's a headphone jack. This is an iPod after all, and even the newest one still has it today. We have the OG home button. Because there is no Touch ID, you will need to set a passcode the old-fashioned way, if that's something you want. Unlocking the iPod, we have the slide to unlock, and there it is, the classic iOS 6 design on only a 3.5-inch screen. But that aside, it looks really, really good thanks to the Retina display, bringing the pixel density up to 326 pixels per inch. Interestingly, this was the first iPod Touch with a Retina display, and Apple released it alongside the iPhone 4, which also brought the Retina display for the first time. Back in 2010, this was by and far the best display on the market, and it was pretty cool that you could get it on Apple's cheapest iOS device. This iPod is really, really small, especially compared to newer iPhones, but I would say that's supposed to be more of a selling point than a detriment for most people. These old iPods were meant to be portable, they should fit in your pocket, and this one really fits that criteria. It's very thin, very light, and it's actually really impressive how much Apple managed to cram into this tiny body back in 2010. If you're gonna actually use this thing as an iPod, you know, for music or something like that, the slim and light enclosure is going to be a really nice feature. Plus, these things fit up to 64 gigabytes, which isn't bad at all, so if you really want to, you could fit quite a bit of music on here. This one specifically is 32 for what it's worth, but there are quite a few options, with 8 being the smallest and 16 being the next step up. The small factor was actually improved upon a couple years later with the iPod Touch 5th generation. That gave it a huge redesign and somehow managed to make the iPod even thinner and lighter, but the iPod 4 is still quite good and holds up very well in 2019 when it comes to the design. One of the negatives of having such a small body is that you're gonna have a small battery. This battery is only 930 milliamp hours. Not to say the battery is bad per se. If you have an iPod that wasn't used much throughout its lifetime, it should last the day without issue, but most of these iPods have been quite heavily used over the years, and as a result the batteries have degraded, so you shouldn't expect much from battery life. Particularly when you get into games and whatnot, you'll notice the life draining really quickly. If you have a good battery though for music and stuff, it can last quite a while. Moving to the rear camera, we have a full 0.7 megapixels, as well as the ability to shoot in 720p somehow. As you can see from the video here, it really can't produce more than a cluster of pixels, which I suppose is actually true for any camera when you think about it, but it's extremely apparent here. 0.7 megapixels is a horrendous count, although perhaps forgivable considering how small this device is. I'll show some photos in a moment, but first, the front-facing camera exists. That's honestly probably the best thing I can say about it. It's 0.3 megapixels, and well, it isn't good. Keep in mind that back in the day, this was the first iPod to have any camera at all, so there's that. There's not much point in analyzing this photo, it's just not a good selfie, and you aren't gonna get one with this iPod. As mentioned in my recent iPad 2 video, these are the worst cameras to ever ever be put into any iOS device, but at least the iPod has an excuse. It was really, really small, smaller than the iPhone, so it makes sense Apple couldn't cram a whole lot into here. But then Apple the next year threw that same camera in the iPad 2, even though the iPad 2 is quite large, so I'm not exactly sure what their line of thinking was there. But regardless, now I'll put up some photos for you to see for yourself. Spec-wise, the iPod Touch 4 was actually pretty good for the time and a decent upgrade over the third generation. It shares the same chipset with the iPhone 4 in the A4 processor, but it has less RAM with only 256 megabytes. The iPhone XS has 16 times that amount of RAM, which is kind of crazy when you think about it. Despite the low count, the iPod doesn't actually perform too poorly on iOS 6. It isn't fast per se, but it's a lot better than if it would have been given the iOS 7 update in 2013. This iPod is updatable to iOS 6.1.6, and for years, that's all you could go to. But interestingly, last year, a method came up where you could actually update your iPod 4 to iOS 7, which is kind of insane, considering Apple never wanted that to be possible. But I'll link a video down below describing how it is possible. I actually worked with the guy who had pretty much set everything up to get it working, and I put a little package together so you could do it for yourself. So I'll link the tutorial in the description as well if you're wanting to do it for some reason. The iPod 4 was essentially unusable on iOS 7 with no Wi-Fi, and it had to use basically the iPhone 4 version of iOS, which is why there's a phone icon. I still don't understand the entire process, but I've heard that people have gotten it more stable, which is cool. Might be something to look into if you want to do something with your old iPod, but keep in mind that doing this will likely render it unusable until you restore back to iOS 6. And you might be wondering how iOS 6 actually performs in 2019. After all, this probably is the most nostalgic part of the device. And the answer is, it's outdated. It is functional though, and while it might not have as many nice features as we have today, nostalgia really, really helps this thing feel awesome to use. It's so different from iOS 12 or even iOS 7. And this is one of the best devices to experience iOS 6 on because of that Retina display. Everything looks crisp and clean, and with relatively spiffy performance. From my experience, it's hard not to enjoy using this iPod. You can actually still download apps, by the way, just the latest compatible versions of them, so you can get old versions of YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and whatnot without too much issue, if you can sign into the App Store at all. Nowadays, Apple makes it really hard not to have two-factor authentication on all of your iOS devices, so most of you probably have that, including me. This is typically not a huge pain with modern devices, but with iOS 6, it wasn't built for that. But Apple to the rescue, it's actually still possible to sign in. Basically, it just has you type in the verification numbers immediately following your password, which is a clever workaround, and mad props to Apple for keeping things usable still. Anyways, most old apps do typically run fine, although you probably will find some issues here and there due to the age of these apps. Like in Instagram, the pictures are shown as the old square, so they're often cut off, plus there aren't any stories. Twitter still locks you at 140 characters, and so on and so forth. Some apps don't work at all, but overall you should be able to find some stuff to do on here. Of course, old games run fine, like Temple Run. It won't be able to handle anything much more demanding, but games from the good old days won't be an issue. One thing I found to be annoying was any type of internet browsing, particularly with the App Store. It's really slow to load anything, and I actually kept getting a blank white screen under the Featured and Search tabs. This made it tough to find any apps. I don't know if this is an issue across the board, if everyone experiences this or not, but it was really annoying. So any apps that I managed to download, I either pulled from the top charts page or from your past downloads page. If you do manage to pull up an app page, you may not be able to install it, like with Netflix here. I don't know why this is the case, because as far as I know, Netflix did run on iOS 6 at one point, but apparently it isn't compatible anymore, so that kind of sucks. This is extremely disappointing to me, because there's nothing I would have liked more than to watch Stranger Things on this 3.5-inch iPod. You could always jailbreak and sideload apps, but I'm not going to get into that today. There's lots of resources online, and if you want more, you could always go to r/legacyjailbreak on Reddit. It's a decent-sized community with a lot of people with these older devices, and they're very helpful over there, so shout out to them. iMessage does work on this iPod, so there's that. I've heard FaceTime doesn't work, but I never tested it, so can't speak for that. Does all this matter? Maybe not. But it is kind of interesting how well you can actually use this iPod if you put some time into it in 2019. And if you don't need it as a main device, because why would you, like, ever, you could always use it for music. An iPod for music might seem a little bit out there, but it is an option. I always loved this iPod and wanted one when I was younger. It's a really cool device, and while it might not have much use anymore, it's nice to see that it actually holds up pretty well right now, 9 years later. And with that, I think I'm pretty much done here. Did you ever have this iPod? Let me know in the comments down below. If you found this video interesting or enjoyable, you could always hit that like button and maybe subscribe for more content just like this. You can follow me over on Twitter and Instagram at 91_tech if you'd like to for some reason. And with that all being said, I'm Josh from 91 Tech, and I will see you all next time.